Hello everyone, greetings and welcome to this episode of Credo Club Listener's Corner, a show where different Credo alumni talk about whatever pieces we want to, because we like them. My name is Will Thain. I went to Credo from 2011 to 2015, was a counselor in 2017 and 18, and was in the orchestra week in Chicago in 2019, where we did Scheherazade and a symphonia concertant with Rachel Barton Pine and Matt Lippman. I'm a violinist. I did my undergrad at McGill University in Montreal. I'm originally from outside of Toronto, Canada, where I am right now. And I'm currently doing my master's at the University of Michigan, studying with Danielle Belen. While I was in Montreal during my last year, summer prior to that, a few of my good friends, two of whom are former OBs, Joshua Morris, Emmy Tisdale, and then my other friend Russell Iceberg, they approached me to help them found this conductorless string ensemble called Ensemble Urbain. One of the main streets in Montreal is Saint-Urbain. We founded this ensemble. It has the mission to play, perform, and promote music by composers from marginalized social groups, LGBTQ plus composers, BIPOC, and women composers. And we gave our first concert in November of 2019. So the piece that I'll be talking about today is one of the pieces that we featured on that first concert. It's called Impressions by Clarice Assad, Impressions for Chamber Orchestra. And it was kind of our feature item on this concert, which we entitled First Impressions because it was our very first concert as an ensemble together. Just a little bit of information on Clarice Assad. She is a Brazilian-American composer, really phenomenal composer. She wrote a lot of pieces commissioned by the New Century Chamber Orchestra, which this piece was also commissioned for. She's also an amazing jazz pianist and scat vocalist. And one of her really, really amazing works is this scat concerto. And there's a video of her on YouTube playing solo piano and then and singing into a microphone with the orchestral accompaniment. And it's absolutely amazing, the vocal dexterity that she has, her ability to just kind of improvise on the piano underneath that. She really does such a fantastic job at synthesizing her jazz training and traditional Brazilian rhythms within the context of a classical orchestra. So let's get started. There are five movements in this piece. They each have a little subtitle to them. So we have Personas, Fusion, Affection, Precision, and then Unity. So let's jump into the first movement called Personas. It is a theme in variations, and what's cool about this movement is that each instrument group in the string orchestra gets their own little solo variation. So we get to see each of the sections working as a cohesive group within the orchestra. Let's have a listen. And then it gets developed more and more. And we will jump ahead to the first variation, which features the first violins. Mm-hmm. Paris. It is a six-part divisi, and everyone has their own little bit that they're doing. It's very contrapuntal, and then they all come together in these elaborate string crossings with just six violins and no lower strings whatsoever. It still ends up being a pretty full orchestration, which is pretty cool. The next variation that we get is the cello section, which is a lot more rock and roll. So the cello variation starts right off from the very end of the first violin section. So here's the end of the first violin section. On like that for a little bit. What was cool about rehearsing this movement is that we had to do very little as an actual ensemble. We ended up booking some rehearsal time and then having all of the sections go to different practice rooms and rehearse as a little unit, because most of the movement was not actually done as an ensemble. It was just done in these little groups. The third variation in here is a bass solo, and it's marked frantic, and it just kind of keeps tumbling forward and forward more and more. On the day of our concert, we had two bassists for this concert, and one of them couldn't come to the concert because someone closed a door onto his bass as he was on his way out of the music school, and it crushed the side ribs. And so about an hour before we were supposed to give our concert, he called us and was like, "I'm so sorry, I don't have a bass to play on, I can't come." Thankfully, he was not the bassist who was playing the solo, so the principal bassist for this concert carried the entire concert on his own, and he was an absolute champ. He plays with the Montreal Symphony now, and he's amazing. This movement was quite entertaining to watch, because he went all in on it and just like was slapping around on his bass, and it was really cool. The fourth variation is the second violins, and after this really intense kind of frantic persona of the bass, these cute little pizzicato like bopping up and down in the second violins. So, coming up, we have a really cool kind of transition into the viola variation, which is kind of serious and marked tragic. And the violins just fade out as the violas come in, and it's a metered fade out, which is kind of cool. But we just get quieter and quieter and quieter and repeat the same bar as the violas enter, and then they give us a cue to cut off. what's cool about this movement, I find, some of you may be familiar with the composer Alberto Ginastera, the Argentinian composer. He wrote this piece for full orchestra called Variaciones Concertantes, which we played at University of Michigan this past semester. And it features every single instrument group in the orchestra, and every principal gets a solo in each movement, which is really cool. And in both this piece and in Ginastera's Variaciones Concertantes, the viola variation is a slow, very dramatic affect to it. And I find it interesting how that persona for the viola is perceived by many composers. So to wrap up this movement, we get everyone coming back together to play the theme once more. And they do it in a way that maintains the affect of the viola variation, and we just have the rest of the orchestra join the violas really organically. It's quite a beautiful ending to the first movement. So that's the first movement of this incredible piece. Let's move on to the second movement, which is called Fusion, Danza Brasileira. So this is as the title would suggest, it's a fusion of jazz and Brazilian dance rhythms. And this was a tricky movement to put together. The principals of the ensemble rehearsed for hours just to lock everything down. It's very rhythmically complex, and we had to be sure that the principals could play it absolutely rock solid before we rehearsed with the rest of the orchestra. Otherwise, it would have wasted a lot of time. Without further ado, let's jump in. There's a lot of kind of little motifs that get passed back and forth. And a lot of these, ya-da-da-dum, ba-da-da-dum, ba-da-da-dum, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-dum. Let me tell you, doing that with 19 people is kind of tricky. But once we all kind of internalized the groove, it flowed really nicely. One thing I appreciate about this ensemble so much is that when we were picking our roster for it, we chose not only people whose playing we respected so much, but who we thought would be fantastic to work with. So rehearsals were so enjoyable because everyone was respectful and so friendly, and everything just went super smoothly because we started with great players. So this movement could have been a nightmare to put together, but it was made a lot easier by the incredible musicians who we were playing with. Concertmaster Emmy Tisdell sounded amazing on this solo, by the way. She just got super into the groove and was like doing all these juicy slides. We were all grinning during that performance because she was killing it. It was awesome. On to the third. The third movement is called Affection, Slow Waltz. And it's probably the most well-known movement from this entire piece. And it's inspired by Hollywood film noir and just very, very romantic, very over-the-top, lush Hollywood bowl kind of sound. Let's take a listen. Yeah, it is so beautiful, so romantic. It really reminds me of some of you may know the song At Last, famously sung by Etta James. In case you don't, here's what it sounds like. Very classic kind of soul Hollywood sound. This movement also gets a lot of really beautiful concertmaster solos, which Emmy also played with such beautiful sensitivity. A lot of the pieces that Clarice Assad wrote for New Century Chamber Orchestra are heavy on the concertmaster solos because at the time, not just Salerno Sonnenberg, who's a pretty famous concert violinist, former student of Dorothy DeLay from Juilliard. She was concertmaster of this orchestra at the time. And so a lot of the pieces kind of blur the lines between violin concerto and string orchestra piece. There's a wonderful recording of another one of her pieces called Dreamscapes on YouTube, where Nadia will frequently stand up and walk to the center of the orchestra to both conduct and play her solos and then go back to her seat. And I love that kind of that fusing of the violin concerto, but kind of tailoring it more towards the chamber music side of things. There's the third movement. I could just keep listening to this forever. The subtitle for the fourth movement is called Precision, and it is a perpetual motion movement. So those always immediately spark fear into me because I think of, well, first I think of the third movement of Barber Violin Concerto, as well as a few other orchestral movements, Bartok Concerto for Orchestra. There are a lot of really, really difficult perpetual motion movements. This is less tricky. It still showcases the skill and proficiency of the orchestra sections working together, but it's not super difficult. Once everyone learned their part, we just kind of ran it through a couple times and set a metronome, and it went like clockwork. If you can play all the notes and you can count, then you're golden. Keeps going and going and going like that. She likes to throw in a little bit of triplets here and there just to throw us off. But it was really, really fun to play. Once we kind of built in the landmark cues for everyone, it flowed so nicely and it was very dramatic. The movement culminates at this big crescendo and then just cuts off. Then it goes straight into the final movement, which is a coda, and the subtext to it is unity. And it just serves as like a closing statement by reflecting on that original theme. Different key. It has a few key shifts that are kind of unexpected. You'd expect it to return to the home key, but it doesn't. Here, let's take a listen. So we just had that massive cutoff, and then we start right in with this. So there was the original theme that we heard in a different key in the very first movement. And I'm going to jump to the ending. And there we have it. That is Impressions for Chamber Orchestra by Clarice Assad. It is such a fantastic piece. Clarice Assad is one of my favorite composers who is alive today. She is just so innovative with her use of different styles from around the world. If you're not familiar with some of her work, I'd highly recommend that you just check out some of her other stuff. So, thank you everyone for chiming in to this episode of Listener's Corner. If you haven't already, I highly recommend that you check out some of the other episodes from Listener's Corner. A lot of them are pieces that I've never heard of, and I love discovering new music, so absolutely go check them out. They're super cool. I hope you all enjoyed this episode. Don't forget to like and subscribe.